Father, we thank you that we're here for you. We're here to bring glory to your name. We're here to say thank you. And Lord, we know that every good and perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights. And you say, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Father, we want to be like Paul when he said, I am what I am by the grace of God. Lord, might we be good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Might we distribute it bountifully and carefully and precisely to all those who are in need. We ask it in Christ's name and for his sake. Amen. Let's stand together, folks. We are going to read a very brief portion of Scripture today out of the Gospel of Luke. Yes, we're there. Rejoice with me, for I have found the peace which I lost. Likewise, I say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Father, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Might our faith be increased today. We ask it in your name. Amen. Amen. You can be seated, folks. I would appreciate that. Excuse me. Is there any polite way of gulping some water while people are looking at you? Probably not. Maybe if I had a silver cup. I don't know. Well, now you know what to get me for Christmas. Right? Yes, Maria? Welcome home. We will keep our banners up there because we are still welcoming you home to the house of God, but we are going to start a new series next week, and it's called Weird, because normal isn't working. That's always been my thought, that we need to be somewhat weird because the normal things that the world embraces are not working, so spread the word, and we'll look forward to a great start to a five-week series next week. But today, sermon number 5 in the Welcome Home series, The Lost Coin. And quite honestly, I have to share with you this morning concerning verse 8, 9, and 10 in this Lost and Found chapter, The Lost Coin. This briefest of excerpts out of this chapter gave you the most difficulty in achieving something practical today. I don't want to just talk at you. I want it to be practical. I want us to wake up on Monday morning and be able to use it and incorporate it into our lives and see God sharpen our skills and help us to be transformed into the image of the Savior. You've heard it before. We're not here for information. We're here for what? teaching, call it the right catechism. They would say certain things, the people would respond for certain things, and it would have been amazing if it ever got through to the heart and really ended up being about a relationship with God rather than just religion. Jesus called them whited sepulchers, whited walls. The Apostle Paul later on called the high priest a whited wall because they looked good on the outside, but they were filled with deception and filth on the inside. Understand that man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. And thank God for that. We moved on to the lost sheep, and Jesus was a little facetious with his listeners. He said, what man of you who has 100 sheep, if one escapes or is lost, which of you will go after the one and leave the 99? And he was speaking about that humanistic mentality that we have, that we wouldn't go after one. We would just cut our losses. We would say, well, at least I still have 99. That's a pretty good ratio. And we would ignore the one. But this lost and found chapter, this shepherd is Jesus. And Jesus does go after the one. Amen? Jesus does care about the lone sheep. And he'll go after the sheep and he'll find it. And it might be wounded because of a predator. He'll bend down, he'll pick up this lost sheep, put it on his shoulder, carry it home, and there will be great rejoicing because that one lost sheep has been found. And we praise God for that. Then we moved on to the lost son, verses 11 to 24. And you know that story. He said, Dad, the youngest son, I want what's coming to me. I want my portion. And Dad did not refuse him. Dad gave him 1/3 of what the family estate was worth. He went off into a far-off country. He squandered his resources on riotous living. He ran out of money. And when he tried to find a job, a famine entered the land. And he was unable to find a job. So he took whatever was available. He ended up watching pigs and feeding pigs. Not a real great profession for a young Jewish boy. And there he was with the pigs when he came to himself. And he said, no, my father's servants are doing a whole lot better than me. They get 3 square meals a day. They have a roof over their head. It would be far better to go back and repent and ask my father if he would forgive me so that I could just be his servant. So he came to himself. This was not salvation. This was not repentance. It was the goodness of God leading him to the right place. And how often does God lead us on a homeward journey? We might not be there yet, but he brings situations into our life so that we'll go in the right direction. So the son goes home, and we find the father sees him afar off, runs towards him, embraces him, kisses his neck, and gives him gifts. The following week, we talked about the gifts that the father gave and the father's embrace. The father's embrace is where salvation and the repentance and the relational things were found. The father placed a robe on his shoulders. The father put a ring on his hand. The father gave him shoes, sandals. The father had the fatted calf killed that had already been prepared. And there was a feast. And we find there was great rejoicing because the lost dead son was now returned and alive to the father. In each story, God the Father is being represented. In each story, a different individual or animal is portrayed with different circumstances. But perhaps you can relate to one of them. And which one? same thing again. Something is lost. The father is being betrayed. The desire set upon the lost thing is there, and it's God being concerned about those that are lost and in need of coming home. I used my imagination a little bit on verses 8 through 10, so you're in a lot of trouble. I would ask myself the question as I deal with the lost coin, how much was it worth? How much was this lost coin worth? She lost one out of the 10. One silver coin out of the 10 is lost by a woman who searches diligently for it. Where and how was her search initiated? Where did she look? What did she do? Her home was the place of scrutiny. I wonder if there's some kind of a hidden message there by our Almighty God concerning losing our way at home, and how we can even be sent homeward bound into the embrace of God because of things that are not right at home. Well, think on that and work that out in your mind during the day. Perhaps there is significance in that. But what did God mean as he gives us verses 8 through 10 and talks about one little lost, dirty coin? What is God trying to teach? Many folks I have noticed have invested in things like mutual funds and other risky endeavors to build their own individual wealth. At times they flourish, right? They increase. You get excited when you see that the market is up and things are going well. Yet something simple like a pandemic can come along and the value comes crashing down, as God just demonstrated. Hopefully teaching us to understand where true value is found. Isaiah 55 and verse 2 says, why do you spend money for that which is not bread? We need to learn what is significant, what is important, what is worthwhile, what will carry you through, what will bring you to the finish line. Now, I was thinking about a show, and I couldn't think of the exact title, but you might know what I'm talking about. I named it The Traveler's Antique Show. And maybe I'm wrong, but there are these guys that were into antiques, and they would go traveling in the countryside to different homes. They'd show up at barns and garages, and people would bring out their stuff. They'd bring out their junk. I'm sorry. They'd bring out their antiques, and they would start dickering concerning what it was worth and what kind of money would be exchanged for what they were selling to these traders, these old things, these antiques. And they'd finally arrive at a fair market value, and these guys seemed pretty honest, but I guess the folks could be taken advantage of pretty easily. If you're like me, maybe you have collected baseball cards. Anybody ever collect baseball cards? Okay. Don again, he's just highlighted today. Baseball cards, how about stamps or coins? Has anybody here collected stamps or coins? Don, a little bit. Okay. Well, you need to think about that. I got involved in it a little bit, but I was a very ignorant kid. And when I had my baseball cards, I would tape them to poster board. I would actually glue them to poster board. So where all the statistics were, that was glued to the poster board, which made them worthless. Okay? I had no idea. You know, it wasn't any big deal. I had Mickey Mantles, Joe DiMaggio's, you know. And I would just glue them to the poster board. You know, and later on I found out that people were actually collecting them and keeping them in mint condition. And there were books that would show exactly how much they were worth, how much your cards were worth, how much your coins. mean, let's be honest about it. What it came down to was what somebody was willing to give you for your card, for your stamp, or for your coin. You could point at the book all day long, but if they didn't want to give you that amount, you would have to compromise and you would have to dicker with them a little bit. I guess it came down to supply and demand. Now, if we notice all three stories in this lost and found chapter, we see different types of people with different circumstances. And I'm sure one of these stories got your attention. Not that you have sheep, but you might have lost something like that. And you might have pushed things aside to go after that one valuable item, or the coin, or the lost son. Maybe you can relate. And again, what about today? This woman loses 1 out of 10 coins at home. And she does a number of things as she searches for her lost coin. So we're going to look at this story diligently in a practical sense and notice some things as we look at our first point and the question, how much was that dirty little coin worth? And you might say, what do you mean, dirty little coin? Well, this little coin was quite insignificant. It might have been worth a lot to her, but for the most part, it wasn't really worth a whole lot, but it was worth a whole lot to her. You and I have different systems of value, don't we? Some of you, if someone handed you $10,000, you would be beside yourself. Others here, you'd say, oh, well, that's cool, you know, because maybe you have a lot of resources and it wouldn't be as valuable to you. It's a matter of perspective, it's a matter of who you are, it's a matter of what you have and what you don't have. Now, I looked up this coin in the original Greek, and this coin was a Greek drachma. A Greek drachma, and you will notice that a number of coins were circulating in Jerusalem during this particular part in history, probably why money changers were needed. Luke 15 and verse 8, it says, what woman having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp, sweep the house? Remember, there were dirt floors. Ever try to sweep a dirt floor? And search carefully until she finds it. This one coin, this drachma, was the amount of temple tribute in the first century due for every adult, from every adult, for temple maintenance. They were commanded to give this drachma, okay? Now, this coin was nearly equal to the Roman denarius, a penny. Do you remember that a penny was worthy of a day's work? Remember that? So if you worked for a day, you would receive a penny. So she technically, with her 10 coins, had 10 days worth of wages. And remember that money like this for women, especially alone, was collected for their dowry. So one coin being lost, as insignificant and a dirty little coin as it was very significant to her. Now, coins in the New Testament, it gave me a headache this week, looking up various coins and figuring out amounts and significance. Hard to distinguish which coins are used sometimes in transactions. But you know some of the stories in the Bible about coins. Remember when they wondered if Jesus would pay taxes and they went and caught that fish and there was a coin in the fish's mouth which bore the emblem of the emperor? Remember the denarius, the penny? Remember the widow's mite? And the widow's mite was called a lepton, a small copper penny short of $1 million, I'm not a millionaire. So I guess I might go down and pick up that penny. So anyway, 30 pieces of silver, or 30 coins for by which the Savior was betrayed, still was not a tremendous amount of money for betraying the Son of God. There was a Tyrian shekel, we're going to get the Phoenicians involved here. This coin bore the imprint of the Phoenician god Melkor, or Baal. So there were a lot of coins circulating in Jerusalem, especially at feast times and celebrations and festivals as people came to town with their money. Now I can list at least 10 more other coins that were in circulation during this time, and again, that's why it was good to have the money changers who were cheating people and not giving them rightfully what should have been theirs. So this coin, the drama, now we're going to get to it, I believe represented humanity. I believe this drama represented sin, curse, human beings, because we remember we're seeing the Father's love for things lost. And we're seeing the Father's love through this woman and her diligence for searching in such an intense manner to find this one dirty little coin. I don't know if you're like me, but I was made dirty through sin. I was born dead in trespasses and sin. And I needed to come to God to be cleaned up. I needed to come to God and taste of His mercy and His forgiveness and enjoy His embrace. We are that little lost, dirty coin. It was a filthy little coin. And understand that humanity, because of the fall, is filled with filthy people before a righteous God who needed His forgiveness. And God is shedding light, amen? God is sweeping. God is doing whatever it takes to find lost sinners. He cares about lost humanity. He cares about that one little lost, dirty coin that represents you and me. Romans 5:12 says, "Wherefore is by one man sin entered the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned." God cares about us, but does everybody care about us? Does everybody in this present world, this present society, think we're unique and special and are going to bend over backwards to meet our need and to love us and to point us in the right direction? No! People in general care about themselves until Jesus enters into our life when we suddenly fall in love with Him and we fall in love with other people. Now there is a wide variety of opinions concerning how much a human being is worth. I guess it's a matter of perspective. I guess it's a matter of who you ask. Some think some human beings are worth more than others. Yet we understand that all lives matter to God, amen? Every life. And it's always been that way. God is no respecter of persons. He views every soul as equal and significant. Peter even cried out in Acts the 10th chapter after dealing with an Italian who wanted to know Jesus. He said, "Of a truth, I perceive that decided not to do that? Well, it was probably worth more to her than to someone else. She wouldn't have worked so hard. I have never swept a dirt floor except helping Nathan clean his room years ago. But I can imagine the dust rising. As they looked for this coin, it must have become even more difficult to find. So it depends. Psalm 142 in verse 4, David said, "No man cared for my soul." How many people care about your soul today? How many people look at you and truly wonder where you're going to spend eternity? I hope if you're a believer, you think about that more often than you used to. I hope you look around when you walk the mall or when we get back to going to sporting events. I hope you look around and the spiritual thought crosses your mind, I wonder how many people here know my Jesus. Because all of these people count and are significant and matter to Almighty God. Great verse, Mark 8:36 says, "For what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? And what shall a man give in exchange for his soul?" I'm spending eternity with God. You could not offer me anything that would be as significant as that. Remember Psalm 8 when it said, "What is man that you're mindful of him? And the son of man that he visits us?" We're worth a lot. That Jesus Christ laid aside his reputation and knew we had a need and knew he was the only one who could meet our need and pushed aside that reputation, humbled himself, and was obedient even to the point of becoming a curse on the cross of Calvary. For this dirty little coin and all of the loose change that is sitting before me this morning, he loves you. You're significant. You're valuable. You're precious in his sight. Don't ever forget that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Great preparation, Psalm 139, went into making you who you are. And he has work for us to do. So do people care about us like Jesus does? I think not. You've heard the statement, one man's junk is another man's treasure. Oh, the times that my wife would walk home with junk in the neighborhood. situations where we might hear the word of God. So a lamp is lit, and then the house is swept. For me to come to Christ, things needed to be stirred up. My life needed to be swept. How about you? In order for God to get my attention. I'm so glad he knows our personality. I had times, and I'm not picking on Nathan today, I had times that I didn't know where he was coming from. And I would try to rationalize, and I would try to get him the common sense of the situation. And then God would come through in a way that I never would have thought, and would get his attention. And sometimes it was bizarre how God got his attention. You're all different. I might look at you and try to wax eloquent and explain something, and you'll look at me and go, huh? And suddenly God will zing you with truth and with the answer. And I'll be preaching on a verse of scripture, and God will give clarification and understanding to many different things through one verse. Have you ever read one verse and you received something entirely different through that one verse, and it met your present need? That's the miraculous hand of God. As he lights a lamp, as he sweeps the house, as he searches diligently for us. Write down Proverbs 20 and verse 27. It says, the spirit of man is the lamp of the Lord, searching all the inner depths of his heart. Friends, God is at work because you're special. And he loves you. And he does not want one human being lost. Do you remember Paul? I should say Saul on the road to Damascus. A bright light shone, and he was knocked down into the dirt off of his horse. And you might not have seen him down there in the dirt, but God saw him. And Jesus said, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? And Saul said, who are you, Lord? And Jesus said, I am Jesus, whom you persecute. And he challenged him. He said, it's hard for you to kick against the goats. And he said, and he trembling and astonished said, Lord, what will you have me to do? Jesus said, arise and go into the city, and it shall be told you what you must do. When you come to Christ, dirty little coin, he has a magnificent plan for you. And he wants to see it fulfilled. Where did he send him? To see Ananias. Where did Ananias live? On a street called Street. Isn't that amazing? Maybe we all ought to take a field trip to a street called Street and come home to the Lord and become what he wants us to be. David said in Psalm 40, verses 1 and 2, let me read it to you. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. He also brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, that's mud, and set my feet upon a rock, and established my steps. He's put a new song in my mouth, praise to our God. Many shall see it and fear, and will trust in the Lord. All right, Mary Lou Coins, which I'm a part of that. One more point, okay? Thirdly, a dirty coin, a drachma, is worth searching for and rejoicing over when found. Only God sees your worth. I used to talk to pastors, and they'd get together, and they'd say, we had a sharp family show up Sunday. And I'd look at them and say, what is sharp? All dressed up. The gentleman had a tie, the woman had a dress. They were all carrying their Bibles. Oh, it was a beautiful thing to see. We are precious, unique, fearfully and wonderfully made. Look at verse 9 with me of Luke 15. Luke 15 and verse 9. It says, and when she had found it, she calls her friends and neighbors together, saying, rejoice with me, for I have found my dirty little coin. No, she didn't say that. I have found the peace which I lost. I wonder what all her friends had to say. Well, if they're in the same boat as her and didn't have much, they knew exactly where she was coming from. Okay? So she calls all of her friends because what she received back, God wants us to know it represents a soul. It's worth going through hell for to reach. To God, it was worth enough to send his one and only Son, who was perfectly righteous and sinless, to become a curse on an ugly tree. That's how much you and I are worth to him. It's worth effort. It's worth embarrassment. It's worth conflict. It's worth contradiction. People will take you the wrong way sometimes when you care. But we should be intense in our labor to find them. Mark down Psalm 126, verses 5 and 6. It talks about spreading precious seed, which is the Word of God, and weeping over that seed. And it says if we'll do that, we will doubtless come again with rejoicing, like she's rejoicing, bringing our crop with us. Sometimes God will honor you, and someone will respond. How often did Paul have people mocked and rejected? But it always says, but some believed. And I thank God for those some, even though God wants them all. Finally, in verse 10, if you look at it with me, it says, likewise. It's kind of like, are you listening? I'm talking to you. That's how we said it in Jersey. I'm talking to you. I say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner, and we neglect this sometimes, who repents. Folks, don't ever forget that repentance is part of the salvation process. The goodness of God leads us to repentance. You can't be saved until you know you're lost, until you know Jesus is God and he rose from the dead and he died for your sin because he's perfect and sinless. We can't come to God till that is all secured. So verse 10 says, again, likewise I say to you. There's joy in the presence of the angels, not for themselves, they don't know what redemption is, but for the sinner who repents and comes home and tastes of the goodness of God. Now you might go home and complain today and say, Pastor said we're dirty little coins. And I'm including myself in that. I'm just a dirty little coin. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. You know I say all the time, I'm just a beggar showing other beggars where to find bread. Amen? There's nothing special about me. Hey, I'm called to preach, but if you know Christ is sinner, we have the same Holy Spirit within us. I listen when you talk. I value what you say. I know you're precious in the sight. I know we're joint heirs of glory. And in the mind of God, we're already there, even though we don't realize it or see it. In the mind of God, we're already saved. We're already there in heaven with him. Thank God that God notices dirty little coins. And he lights light. And he sweeps the floor. And he diligently searches. He's searching right now. Every time a missionary comes through, he says, God laid such and such a place on my heart. We ought to say, praise God. God is searching. God is sweeping. God is shedding light on the situation. Let's get behind him. Let's bow before a word of prayer together, friends. Heads bowed and eyes closed. As I said to you earlier, it's kind of difficult ought to be thanking Him every day. You are not home yet. Don't get despondent and in despair over life's problems. He's a great God. And He's doing great things. And He's working on the behalf of people. Let's be co-laborers together with Christ. Let's be His ambassadors. I don't even know what to ask you except to say and ask, has God spoken to your heart today? Has God brought something to mind that perhaps helped you or encouraged you or motivated you? And you might just say, hey, Pastor, pray for me. God spoke to my heart. Anybody like that today? Thank you, dear lady. I see you. Anybody else? God spoke to my heart. God brought something to mind through this woman and her coin that I wouldn't have thought of before. I see your hand, sir. I see your hand, brother. Thank you. Somebody else, God spoke to my heart. Thank you, brother. I see your hand. Somebody else, God spoke to my heart. He brought something to mind that I probably wouldn't have thought of if it wasn't for His Holy Spirit driving the Word of God home. Pray for me, Pastor. Because I know God wants us to do some things with what we receive. The Lost and Found chapter. How much He loves us. Father, we thank You that we can be here today. And Father, like the song is playing, just as we are without one plea, just dirtier than the coins, Lord. And we have that treasure in our earthen vessels. Jesus living in us. Jesus living in these dirty little coins. Wow, thank You. Thank You. We don't get it, but we readily receive it, and we're so grateful for Your grace. Bless these dear folks here today that we would go out and do a work for Jesus Christ. We love You.